himself quoted Deuteronomy each time he was tempted by Satan during his 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness. He quoted Deuteronomy 6:13, which says, "Thou shalt fear the Lord thy God and serve him, and shall swear by his name." In the 16th verse says, "Ye shall not tempt the Lord your God as we attempted him in Manasseh." And in 8:3, he said, "And he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger and feed thee with manna, which thou knowest not, neither and thy father knoweth, that he might be there, and knoweth man thou, not live man that shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that it proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord thy God." When a lawyer asked Jesus, "Which is the greatest commandment in the law?" in Matthew 22:36, Deuteronomy again provided the answer. "Thou shalt love the Lord with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind." In verse 6, it goes on to say, "These words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart." It was oblivious. Jesus had obeyed the commandment and hidden the words in his heart so that he would not sin against God. We can do the same if we memorize the words, meditating on them in day and night in order to obey and be blessed by it. Love the Lord with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might. Deuteronomy, justice and the disadvantaged. Who are disadvantaged? Name some disadvantaged people. The poor, fatherless, widowed, motherless, homeless. Are we all disadvantaged? Okay. We all disadvantaged until we fully understand Christ. Will we ever fully understand Christ? Not in this world, one day. But speaking of the homeless, did y'all see on the news where right there in Monk's Corner that we have homeless people? We have homeless people right here in Pineville. But in the Monk's Corner area, the pastors, one of our pastors, Reverend Tory Lifridge, he and a group of pastors, they camped out right there across from the Berkeley County government. And I saw the pause, and I saw their tents when I was going to work. They were out there. 4 o'clock in the morning, they were out. They were still out there. Their tents were out there, showing up the homeless. And when we put, and my mindset is always like this, when we put a lot of billions and millions of dollars in sending stuff into space and right around and just seem like throwing money away, which it might not be, but throwing money, why can't we take care of home? You know, why can't we take care of home? If it's homeless people, why? Berkeley County does not have a homeless shelter. And I wonder why. But with them stepping out and bringing that to light, that we need a homeless shelter here in Berkeley County, which we do. We have a lot of children that are homeless. And homeless, you know, it could be that their fire, like a fire has destroyed their home. You know, maybe their parents during this time, they couldn't pay the mortgage. And they have, you know, lost their home. Or another parent that may lost their homes. You know, they could have lost their home. Yes, ma'am? Hmm. as they say, sometimes homelessness is just a choice because you don't want, you know, you don't want to abide by the rules. And that goes not only for adults, that goes for children too. You hear some children say, oh, I don't live with my mom and my dad anymore. Well, where you live? I live with a friend. You see? And we say that if they're not brought up in the church, but I beg to differ there, you know, because you can be brought up in the church. You can start from an baby coming to church, and your parents can bring you to church. You can go to watch night. You can come to watch night. You in Sunday school. You in church. But as you get older, you stray away from your bringing up and for your foundation. No, you don't teach the wrong thing. When I was working, when I was working in a different job, and when I was doing attendance, and someone brought in the obituary because they were out of school. So me, I like to read the obituary, you know what I'm saying? And for this particular obituary, it had on the obituary that he was brought up in the church. He worked in the church. But the world got to him some kind of way, and he got into the world, so he turned from the church. But if it wasn't for his praying grandmother and his praying aunt, he got to turn his life around. And he came back to where he was taught. And sometimes when we are here in the church and we say, well, oh, if you keep up in the church, you keep in church. But the world is full of pressure out there. And sometimes, sometimes we are, I won't say weak, but we are tempted by the world, and the world can pull us more into it, and not being weak, but that's just the way our life is designed to be. But we keep praying and trusting that if they turn and we see them turning, that we can turn them back, you know, and we can turn them back. And sometimes you say, well, and why is their life like this? Because they've always been there. We, you know, always been brought up in the church. We're looking at them that, what is their story? Do we ask, what is their story? You know, just because they are not here doesn't mean that they're not in the Word. But we, as a church body, we know of these people, and we have to keep praying. We have to keep trusting that they will turn their life around and come back to the church, or don't forget, you know, and listen to their voices saying, hold strong, you know, and knowing that we care for them, we shouldn't turn our back. And every time, and if you know somebody's been brought up in the church, and we don't see them in church, and every time we see them, man, you need to be in church. You need to be in church. Let's not do that. You know, let's not do that. Let's say to them, I miss you. You know, I hope to see you soon. You know, you hope to see you soon. Go ahead.
Jesus is not saying that the person will not
when I work in working in the school setting, you see children and you see them, and you know that children right here in this church. And if I say, hey, Miss Tootan, I miss you. You see me every day? I miss you. Miss you on Sunday. All I say, see you soon. See you soon. I've had, and right here in this church, and I'm teaching Sunday school, I have had students come on Sunday school class. We do Sunday school, and after Sunday school is over, they go back home. Why? We don't know their story. Judge ye not. We don't judge them, but we pray for them, and we thank you. Hey, thank you for coming. I'll see you next Sunday. Or thank you for coming. And we as a group of people, and I always say we as blacks, we always at a disadvantage. We have to work harder. We have to do harder. But instead of us lifting each other up, we like to tear each other down. We like to tear each other down. You don't know my story. Right now I have on some shoes, look like house shoes, but they're not shoes, but you don't know my story. You might see me and you don't know my story. You don't know that I get up 2:30 or 3 o'clock in the morning and go to work. You don't know my story, that I work 2 or 3 jobs. You don't know a person's story. So instead of judging them, keep encouraging them. I got a niece and a nephew, they'll tell you what I tell them. My best niece and nephew in the world. Hey, best nephew in the world. Hey, best niece in the world. That's what I do. God, children, children, you like to encourage them. They'll tell you, right now I can use Reverend Milligan's peach and plum, tea and tot. But I could never get their names, and I'm not really good. I know I can tell you your last name, but your first names I can't remember. That's just something new. But I always give them a name. I always call them peach and plum. That's just something, that's how I can distinguish them. Hey, sweetie, how you doing? Let's always, in our youth, young people are dear to my heart. Young people, and always give them that encouragement. Let's not judge them. Let's not judge the disadvantage. And Christ taught us, let's not judge. We care for the widows. We care for the fatherless. We care for those poor. Now I was looking, and why does it always have to be, why always have to be, say, black people? White against black, looking in a phone, not reading, looking up these words, and I looked in a phone. It was looking in my phone. A young girl, she in the fourth grade. Well, I'm here to tell you, lunch is not what it used to be. It's always healthy. So they give you a packet of apples, packet of carrots, just healthy stuff. Well, anyway, she threw her lunch in the trash. Do you know the work that lady dug in that, got went in that trash, wiped the paper off, I'm going to say it was carrots, made the little girl eat her lunch that she threw away out the trash can. Humiliated her in the front of her peers, in the front. Mind you now, she goes home and tell it, they roll the tape back. The worker, she got fired. The principal, he got fired because he didn't do anything to the worker. But why was it like that? Why? Why did she have to do that? And I hate to say this, because she was white and the little girl was black. And children are always at a disadvantage. Children are always at a disadvantage. Children are the ones, I can quote my daddy on this, children are the ones that always suffer, And we tell children, and we teach children, always do what's right. Tell the truth. But you bring it home, and your parents going to fight your battles. But then sometimes we as parents, we don't fight the right battle. We don't come because they got a 50, they got a 50 in the class or something. You call them in. Can you have a conference with the teacher? You ain't got time for the conference. But you take their cell phone, they'll be up there just like that. I want to get my child's phone. So what's is more important, the phone or the grade? You know, and I know y'all can say I'm preaching to the choir and everything, but I'm just saying we as a people, we have to encourage and instill in us. We are at a disadvantage. We are at a disadvantage. We have to work twice as hard, twice as long. And we have to keep whatever we got up here. Don't let everybody know what you got. Keep something back, you know? Keep a secret or two. But like I say, you don't know their story and why the people are disadvantaged. But Christ is always saying that when we have debtors, if you loan somebody some money, like back in the day they said, if you loan and you don't go in their house and try to take their security. But I was, you know, if you loan someone some money, be able to afford, you can loan them some money, because guess what? You might not get it back. You know? You might not get it back, but be able to loan them, and you don't judge people. You know? Because I used to always keep an apple on my desk. Ms. Stewart, can I get a dollar? Sure. Give him a dollar. He come back. Ms. Stewart, can I get a dollar? I said, no, that same dollar that you took the last time, that's the dollar you still have, because you didn't bring back. Because see, if you brought the dollar back, then you can come back again. But I ain't going to say, bring my dollar back. You know, I'm not going to say that. And there was a little boy, ninth grader. He came up to the front. He was crying. I'm like, you know, he was nervous. I said, what's the matter? He said, I'm supposed to pay for lunch, and I didn't know it was the first day of school, and I don't have any money. And I said, well, how much is it? He said, a dollar, whatever, dollar, 25, whatever. I gave it to him. I said, hey, go over and get your lunch. So the next day, he came back to me, and he said, thank you, and gave me the money back. He said, thank you for giving me the money to buy my lunch. I appreciate it. And I said, okay. I said, well, you can come back to me anytime. A couple of weeks later, his grandmama came to pick him up. And he must be said, that's her. And she said, oh, you're the lady that, you know, gave him the money. She said, we really appreciate it. He came home, you know, and said what you did for him. But I didn't do it for that. I mean, you know, he was hungry and tried. But, you know, and that's what I wanted to do to help him out. But anyway, the Lord is telling us that when we back in the day in Deuteronomy, that the debt of you borrowed from, if someone borrowed from you and you take like their coat for security, when it turned cold that night, you should give them their coat back, or you give them their sleeping coat back. Don't hold on to it. You know, that you owe me and I'm a hold this for you. You know, so if you let somebody borrow something from you, borrow some money from you, okay, they got you one time. They ain't bring it back. When they come again, you might soften and do it again. But that third time, you remember two times before? Okay, you add all that up and keep it. Hate to say that, but that's how it is. You know, because I used to be in town, a little young man, so I said, can I get $2? Yeah, can I get $2? I said, let me tell you one thing. Every time I come to the store, you sitting down here asking me for $2. I said, no, this is it now. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead. Exactly. If you can do it. Like they'll say, can I borrow some tissue? No, you can have the tissue, because you're not going to give the tissue back. No, I'm just saying, but that's just an example. But I see what you're saying. You want to borrow and lend. But God teaches us that if we lend, we're not supposed to broadcast it. Just like if we give somebody something to somebody, or you help someone out, why should I go and tell everybody, you know what I did for them last week? You know what I did for them last week? I bought them this again. We're not supposed to do that. If you do it, you do it from the heart. Exactly. And we here at the church, we are, and that's with the church too, when we have, they say take care, we take care of one another. Now here we have a food pantry. I say pantry because the bank is in, but we have a food pantry. And we're here. And if you truly need it, if you truly need, we are here for you. They always say, well, come out on Wednesdays. Those of us who work can't get out here, but those of us who can't work. And sometimes on Sunday, and I think they're going to do something today, but on Sundays, they give out as well because a person may can't come during the week. But Sunday is a good time, and then some people really need it and be right here in church, but they will never ask because they figure that we are judging them. You know, and we shouldn't judge people. Like I said, judge ye not. But the book of Deuteronomy also reveals many attributes about God. God is jealous, faithful, loving, holy, merciful, and yet angered by sin. Indeed, it in these attributes of God that makes him concerned about his people and especially the disadvantaged. So all of us in here care about people, right? To some extent? Yes, to some extent. To some extent. Because, you know, some people, and I hate to say this, but some people will take advantage of you. They take your kindness for a weakness. And they figure that, oh, don't worry about it. She got it, and you know, she don't mind giving it, and I can get it in time. But again, you don't know my story. You know, you don't know, and everybody has a story. And you don't know the backside of the story. You don't know if you work in two or three jobs, if you staying up all night wearing it. You know, you don't worry if you wear the same shoe, if you wear the same shoe over and over again. And because you want to do something else, and then the shoe tears up on you. You know? They don't know that part of the story. But they just see you from the outside. And we always put our best on the outside. And we always want to look our best, but people can look at you and say, oh, I know right now. I can go to Love right here. You're in Love? Sure, my daughter. You know? But then she knows that, and then if she knows my story, she can, you know, she'll always be, and she'll let me come back again. Because that's the relationship, and she knows my story. But then someone else can come to her and say, oh, I can go to her. She got it. Then, you know, she can go to her again. You know, being soft-hearted, kind-hearted, okay. But then don't take advantage of her because she is like that. But then you have to find some people that will take advantage of you because of your kind-heartedness. And, oh, they in the church, and the church teach them to love. You know, and we do. We love one another. Yes, sir. Exactly, but you can show them that you're loving them, but we as a brother and sister as well, we need to be able to do it from the heart and keep it confidential. You know, keep it confidential. You know, if I give you $5, it's not for you to say, oh, Lisa gave me $5, or I gave them songs, you know, or I gave Jerome $5, you know, I gave Green $5, you know, I gave them gas money. Let's not do that. And when they come to you, don't judge them. You know, let's not be a people about judge, but let's be wise. Because like I say, people will try to take advantage of you. Yes, sir. Exactly. We have to have a discerning spirit. Exactly. So, with that in mind, we didn't get through all the lesson, but I believe we got to lesson about that. Let's love one another. Let's judge ye not. Love one another. You know? And like I always say, and this is what I always stand with, you don't know my story. If I'm in your circle, I may know your story, but I may not know the whole story. I may know 5 chapters, and the book has 20 chapters, but again, you don't know my story. But let's be compassionate and love one another and not judge each other. Have a blessed day, a blessed week, and we'll see you all again next Sunday.